Welcome to the second episode of the offseason of our DTF Film Sessions. This is going to be Jalen Carter, the defensive tackle out of Georgia. And with me to help break him down for you all is Nick Merriam, our director of draft content and scouting over at Defiant Takes Football. How are you doing today, Nick?
Doing well. Excited to, you know, continue down our board here and talk about different position groups because I, you know, it helps me practice talking about all these different types of players that we're dealing with a little bit.
Yeah, for sure. So we're just getting started. We're hopefully going to hit somewhere close to the top 50 in terms of prospects. We're going to try and start off at a good pace and carry it on. And Kyron's going to do some of the offensive line prospects for us. So if we get through the top 10, you're like, why are you doing the top 10 prospects, top 15, and you haven't seen an offensive lineman pop up yet? That's because Kyron and I are going to be working on those coming up real soon. But today we're doing a defensive tackle, and Jalen Carter has been one of the top prospects in the draft for, you know, 2 years now. A lot of people talked about him as being one of the best players on that Georgia defense even last year, so there was a lot of hype for him coming into the draft this year. And we're looking at, you know, a player who's pretty well developed from a big-time program with a lot of physical traits. And, you know, I don't think this is something to overthink, but if we're looking at exactly what his strengths are and what his weaknesses are, what would you say they are at this point?
Well, obviously he's physically gifted to a point where you trust him in the NFL. Like, his body is ready for the NFL. He has the tools. He's probably going to test well. That's, you know, a baseline of that is nice to see from any defensive tackle. I don't think he's the most, you know, Jordan Davis tools the defensive tackle we've seen, but he's up there for sure. I think he plays like a veteran. I think you kind of see, you know, the cognition of his brain, like just kind of working through plays. Like, he, Georgia moves him up and down the line, has him do a bunch of different things because they trust him, and he's been in that defense for a long time. This is a guy who could have come out last year and would have been a top, might have been the number one pick, probably actually would have been the number one pick last year if he went into the draft. So it's a combination of experience, physical tools, and just overall production. It's really like, these are the things that you look at with defensive linemen that normally get you drafted potentially number one overall.
Yeah. And just to be clear, because I'm not sure how much experience everybody comes into this with, he was not eligible for the draft last year. So it was not a decision. It was just, I mean, he had to play, so, or he had to wait at least one more year to be draft eligible. So we've got a number of clips today, so we're going to jump right into it. And the first one, here we go. Let's do it like this. It's a little better. All right, take it away.
All right, so he's lined up as three tech here, and we're going to see him move a lot. Georgia moves their front around. They do a lot of weird things, especially different on early downs and third down. But three tech is where he's going to be lining up in the NFL. So this is just a good showcase of his bend right off the bat, right? He is 6'3", 300 pounds. Can you bend under an offensive lineman? There are really good defensive tackles in the NFL that struggle with this. And you can see him dip under and get pressure on the quarterback, get a hit on Bo Nix. We chart that as. Now, this play doesn't actually get affected at all because it is a design screen. You would throw this out on pressure read. It's actually a design drag screen, believe it or not, if you're not looking downfield. If we were to go back and see it again, the receivers that are going out on the left side are blocking downfield. This is a design drag route to the crossing receiver. So this is a good play call for getting around this initial pressure, but it does just showcase the ability for a guy at his size to get under pad level and get to a quarterback.
Yeah, so it's a design screen, but it's not one of the design screens that asks the offensive lineman to allow the defensive lineman to get through. Mm-hmm. So the fact that he already has this leverage on the O-lineman, it's pretty impressive, to be honest.
It is hard to get hits on screen plays in general. We don't, when I was at SIS, we don't chart pressures on screens because quarterbacks generally drift in a way that invites pressure and the offensive line doesn't always block. But we do chart hits, and they don't happen often, and that would be one.
All right. Let's go to our next clip here.
So this is going to be a run play that goes away from Carter, and he's a five tech lined up on the edge on the right tackle. First of all, I want to point out, I did a double take on this play. Like, that's the right tackle, and I thought it was a tight end, like looking at Carter matchup on him. Now, obviously, like, some defensive tackles are going to look bigger than offensive tackles, but in the NFL, like, you're not going to see that often. And really, like, he just physically looks way bigger than the player he's matching up against here. And that in itself is just kind of, you know, a theme of this tape is just physically he's a different player, right? But his job simply here is to set the edge. And although the run is away from him, out of stance, his hands are on the shoulder pads of this tackle. If we play through it, we can pause on the back end. But you can see he's going to swim over this tackle, and the play goes away from him. It's not really a rep that you see production from, but it's impressive to me because although I don't like seeing defensive linemen swim a whole lot because it generally shows that they're, you know, not always in the best leverage position, here he gets at a stance and immediately his hands are on the shoulder pads of this offensive tackle. That tackle is going way low, and he basically just sidesteps him. Like, this is a veteran move. This is kind of like this is the processing I talked about earlier, where he is just kind of a step ahead of this tackle who is not quite the level of player that most players he's going up against aren't, of Jalen Carter. And he's able to just effectively, this run comes his way, he's blowing it up. That's a loss of the yardage, right?
Yeah, probably not a good idea to run at him too often. All right.
So we've seen him at 3 tech and 5 tech now, right? And now he's kind of shading 4-eye. This might be 3. This is Georgia in their odd front now. They do all sorts of weird things. I think a lot of people have actually seen this clip. This is all power and strength from him. He out leverages the offensive. I believe it's going to be the right guard here, right off. It might be the right tackle again. I don't know. He might be bullying the right tackle a ton in this game, but he gets leverage immediately. And Carter just right off the bat knows this, and he just runs through him. Like, it's just pure physical power to speed, you know, inertia buildup. And what's more impressive, I think, is what he does after that, when he knocks the offensive lineman to the ground, is the range then for him to leave his feet and make this tackle. Because that running back identifies that the hold's clogged up and actually does a good job bouncing this. It does not matter because Carter has this ability to kind of leave his feet, use his arms. This is an impressive, like body control play from a guy of 300 pounds to make this tackle.
Yeah, I'm not sure exactly what the physical profile is of this running back, but at this point, he said, this gap is mine and you're bouncing this out or going nowhere. And so the running back tries and it's just not going to happen.
And he does get help from the safety crashing down as well, but this is still, I mean, he is parallel to the ground making this tackle. This is the type of play you see corners making, right? Like,
yes. It's not shoestring layout either. Like, he's got him solidly. All right, do we want to hit this one more time, or do we want to?
We can move on here. Some of these in the beginning are just kind of short, like showing his physical profile. We're going to get into some more like schematic things here at some point that really kind of show how Georgia used him. But play 4, so again, we're in an odd front, 3-down lineman. This is a 2-gapping play for him, and we're kind of seeing a lot of 3-4 defensive end from him. He does play some nose tackle, but I don't think that's where he's going to be at the NFL level. He might add some weight and be able to reduce down on 5-down alignments, but we'll see. So how does he control space here against this RPO Oregon offense? They've been in the RPO heavy offense, it seems, forever. Like, that's kind of been Oregon's thing. It's probably what hurt Marcus Mariota as a quarterback. Bo Nix, similar, right? He's going to get lined up on the tackle here, and he's got the 2-gap, that B-gap, and the C-gap. And he actually does a great job here forcing Bo Nix to bounce this pull all the way out to effectively for no gain to the D-gap out of bounds. So first of all, let's run the clip. Just watch the whole play. You're going to see that he does a good job here. Like, he has control of that offensive lineman. If that ball goes to the B or C, like, he's going to have it. Let's pause right when he gauges here. Clear leverage to the B gap, right? If that ball is coming inside, he's in a great position to make that tackle. But it's also his responsibility to make sure if that ball gets bounced that he can cover the C gap. And look how easy it is for him to control this offensive lineman and then get across him to the C gap and force Bo Nix to not just bounce this ball, like, to the C, but even further, and effectively because of how well George rallies up, take no gain on this play.
Okay, so just to translate first, you know, some people don't know all the verbiage, but basically where he is on this tackle, he is controlling both sides. So if the quarterback wants to come up this direction, then he's got that covered, and he has the leverage and the balance where if he wants to take it outside, which he does, he's able to control that as well. When the quarterback decides not to take either one of those gaps, he basically runs around the other action of the play, and he's also there if he were to have slipped through that. It wouldn't really be a D gap at that point, but basically that's, you know, he's there to cover all three in reality, even though only two are his responsibility.
Well, yeah. I mean, so D gap generally,
as you watch that here, you can kind of see.
We can call that like anything outside C in a lot of cases because it really, you know, but yes. Without getting too technical, yes. Okay, play number 5. As we can see this again, like, this is an individual play that doesn't show up on the stat sheet that's very good from him. But now we are kind of in this, I believe, I don't know if that's the center. So now he's straight up two-tacking. Like, he's just right over that guard. And we're going to see him kind of reduce into nose eventually here as we go through these plays. This is a really quick out-of-stance play from him. Or this isn't a quick out-of-stance play for him. Sorry, my notes are a little bit messy. But he's able to kind of fire off at the quarterback here and really force his play to break down and force C.J. Stroud to make a play with his feet and improvising outside the pocket without really having to burn this guard. This is fully like stutter, swim around. But the impressive thing to me is the closing speed on the quarterback. And I think that is what really boosted guys like Christian Barmore, who maybe didn't go as high as they thought he would, and Quinnen Williams really, was their ability when they beat this offensive guard to close. And this is like a sign that you're going to, at the very least, have a very, very good 10 split in the 40-yard dash. And it's an important trait because some guys like are really good at winning at the point of attack, but they don't have the speed to get upfield and they don't have the speed to catch a quarterback. We see the movement here, like his feet. He puts the guard off balance by shooting a little horizontal wiggle. And at a 300 pounds, it's tough to go from kind of like chopping your feet, not at full speed, to now we're firing off at the quarterback and forcing him to move. Stroud makes an amazing play here. Not every quarterback is going to be able to do this. Part of this is maybe that Jordan doesn't contain the pocket super well, but it's such a quick play from Carter. He almost is playing ahead of everybody else that it's like he almost plays himself into a position where he can't make the play. But it is impressive to kind of see this explosiveness upfield off of a horizontal body movement pass rush move.
Yeah, I think it should be stated that the fact that that was not a sack or at the very least an incompletion is a testament to C.J. Stroud. Mm-hmm. And it was a very nice play. All right, what do we have here?
So we're fully reduced down now. We're one tech on the left side, and these next two players are going to show the same thing twice, right? So we're going to ask Jalen Carter on this play to loop, not around the other defensive tackle, but around the edge player as well, and take on the opposite side tackle and the left tackle, which is just kind of like not a thing you will do in the NFL, like unless you're Aaron Donald or someone fantastic. But in college, you could ask Jalen Carter to do it. And it just – this shows how much Georgia tried to get out of him. And that's important for a couple of reasons. For one, the trust that this coaching staff has in him as a player is they know he's the best player on the field. They are using him in ways that Ohio State won't expect. They don't line up in this look and go, oh, Jalen Carter is going to attack to the strong side of their defensive alignment because they have a three tech, like they're playing further over to the side that they expect effectively maybe the play to go right. But that's because of the stacking of the tight end over there. That's the strong side of the offensive formation. Carter is expected to maybe be trying to controlling those weak side gaps, but because it's a drop back pass, they have a schemed up loop here. He doesn't actually go around the defensive tackle, but he does have to run a really long way to make this play. And if he gets more support from the rest of his defensive line, it's possible that his ability to push this tackle backwards could create an issue for C.J. Stroud. And we're actually going to see this again on this next clip. They're going to ask him to do it again. And the next one I think is an even better rep because he actually does get around that tackle. This is more of a speed to power rush. We're going to see just a straight speed rush from him. And it's impressive to be able to win in both ways, really, because the idea that you need to reach, this is like 5 yards, and then they're 5 yards upfield. You're turning the corner. It requires a certain amount of athleticism in itself to be able to make this play. And then affect the quarterback in any way whatsoever is just – it's not unheard of, but it's extremely rare, right? Like, this is why a guy like this gets thought of as a top prospect, is your ability to affect the pocket in ways that no one else really can. And I will say, maybe a limitation from this, it's important to note that he might freelance a little bit too much in this Georgia defense because of how much they trust him. Like, they are telling him, dude, you're our best pass rusher, you're our best run defender, just do your thing. Like, beat the guy in front of you, make the play. And he does this. In the NFL, you're going to be a little more structured. It's a little harder to freelance. There are guys that do it. Like a J.J. Watt comes to mind, but that's J.J. Watt, right? Like, we trust a J.J. Watt to do whatever he wants, right? Because he's that type of player. So when you're that level of player in college, it's easy to see why we're talking about this guy as a potential top three pick in the draft and probably will be.
Yeah. I mean, I fully expect that at this point. And I think it would be realistic for him to drop to somewhere else in the top five, just depending on how teams traded for quarterbacks. And mm-hmm. if ultimately somebody decides that Will Anderson is their guy, which, you know, it would not be shocking at all. I think
5 for both of them is the floor, probably.
Yeah. I think that makes a lot of sense. So, and it could be as high as 2 or 1 for either one, potentially, theoretically. So, I mean, the last thing I want to point out is that, you know, we've seen it, but to make a note of it, he has played at how many different techniques just in this set of clips? I mean, we've seen him at I think 5. We've seen him head up over the tackle on the right side. We've seen him outside tackle at what I guess would be like probably like true 5 tech. I don't remember what he was at that clip. We've seen him at 3, 2i, head up over the guard, I think. So, and on both sides. So we've just seen him play every single different defensive position that you really ever ask a defensive lineman to play. He probably won't really play nose much, but on pure passing downs, maybe he will, because he's definitely going to have a size advantage over the average NFL center. So there's, aside from just the technique and the athletic ability, there's a versatility there too that makes him a really appealing defensive lineman. Anything else that you want to say about Jalen Carter before we close out our second episode here?
No, just repeating what we've said in previous videos, really, that positional versatility is really helpful for teams that are rebuilding a full roster, because when you have that guy, it allows you to identify specific players later on when you're drafting lower in the draft and players don't have that versatility, where to fill in, right? Carter could be playing in any number of roles in the NFL on different downs, but specifically, you know, he is a 3-tech. Anything more than that is going to be good for whatever defense requires him.
All right. I like it. So Jalen Carter is going to be a top 3 pick more than likely in this draft. In a couple of weeks here, you will have your big board out. And if you're watching this, not immediately after we drop it, you can probably go find that. Might go back and add it to the show notes once it's once that's done, so that people can find that. And of course, check out all of our prospect profiles at DefiantTakesFootball.com, and you can find all of our other DTF film sessions. And finally, check out the Defiant Takes Football show every Monday and Thursday morning live from 10 a.m. to 12 p.m. Eastern time. All right, Nick, appreciate you, and we are going to get suited up to do a CJ Stroud review right now.